Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Hiren Gada on behalf of the entire Kutch Corporate Forum community, and I would like to welcome you all to our second webinar in a span of just 5 days. It is your faith in us because of which we are able to deliver quality programs to you since the past 25 years. Today, our keynote speaker, Mr. Suraj Shah, is going to talk about how through mindfulness, we can keep our mind free from the negativity and clutter spreading all around us. Suraj Shah has done MS in clinical psychology. He is a faculty in charge for the Department of Psychology at the Nahar International School, Powai. He is a psychotherapist and marriage counselor. He is a corporate mindfulness trainer and a health psychologist for psychosomatic illness. A very young and energetic person, I am sure that you will enjoy this. Attendees can ask their questions in the Q&A section available below your screen. We will try to answer as many of your or all your questions after the speech of Mr. Suraj Shah. Now I request Mr. Suraj Shah to take over. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, Hiren Bhai. Good evening. Namaste to each and every one who have joined us. I would like to first thank KCF and the entire team, Mr. Philip, Mr. Hiren, for giving me this opportunity to present the topic, which is, I think, very relevant in the current time, right? So we'll be going through a presentation and I'll be starting the presentation. Give me a second. Okay, so let's start with our presentation. Okay, so the topic is de-stress and feel fresh through mindfulness. Yes. So before we directly jump onto this topic, first let us talk about the psychological impact of the pandemic, right? I'm sure we are all having a biological impact. We are trying to understand how this pandemic or the crisis is affecting us in terms of physically. But I'm sure we all of us know that it has an impact on our mind, right? So we'll be first trying to understand the response style spectrum. That is, the situation is one, right? But people have a different response to the same situation based on their own thinking styles, based on their own personalities, right? So I will be talking a little bit in Hindi and English. I'll be trying to juggle with both languages. So, okay. So, the situation is one, ek hi ghatna hai, but we have different response. Uski pratikriya alag alag hai, right? So we'll try to understand the three basic response styles that, you know, could have emerged in this situation. The first half is the left hand, the left extreme is the callous one. And to, you know, to add just a human element, I will call that category as mastaram. The other extreme is the anxious one, or to add the human element, I would call it chintara. And the mid one, which is like in between, the balanced, more rational, is the person who is more concerned. And I would call, you know, that category as Shrira. So we all are aiming at to come to a more balanced response style than being on the either of the extremes, right? So the whole purpose of this is to introspect and see where do I fall and how can I bring myself back to being more concerned and, you know, being the Shrira. So let us first understand the extremes, then we'll understand how to get to the mid one. Okay. So let us first understand the first extreme, which is, you know, being very anxious and not being able to somehow, you know, tolerate this uncertainty that these times are bringing with itself. So what happened, there's a class of people who are getting very anxious with the situation, and what they're engaging in, the kind of thinking they're engaging in, is called as catastrophizing. What is catastrophizing? In Hindi, I would call it aisi mansikta jisme hum cheezon ko bhayankar banate hain hamare dimag mein, bhayankarikaran. So I'm magnifying things to be very, very catastrophic. And what is resulting? because of this is I get so anxious, and I'm going to be either, you know, focusing constantly on negative news, constantly asking for reassurance. And what does it lead to? Either fight, flight, or freeze. These are basic three responses, right? So either I'm going to be overdoing things, like over cautious, hyper vigilant, or I'm going to be like very, very frozen, like I just don't know what to do because I'm so overwhelmed with these emotions, right? So in Hindi, what will it lead to? Mansik sangharsh, tanav, nirasha. I might be very hopeless or even very scared. So this is the one spectrum. I think one of the examples I would like to give for this is, we know the German financial minister seemed to have committed suicide because of this, the virus crisis worries. We know that the economy is falling, it's declining. So somehow he just, you know, couldn't have contained the amount of, you know, he could have just, he was so scared with this that he just lost all the hopes, right? So we don't want to fall in this spectrum. Now let's talk about the another spectrum, the other extreme, which is being very callous and irrational, irrationally optimistic, right? So there is a category of people, especially we do watch, you know, see in India also, who are undermining the risk or the severity of the situation. So again, either people will be like very optimistic, humko to kuch nahi hoga, right? ये सब कोरोना बोरोना हमको नहीं होता है. और द अदर एक्सट्रीम कुड बी, होगा तो होगा, मरना ही है एक दिन. सो अगेन आई एम बीइंग कैलस. सो व्हाट डज इट रिजल्ट टू? आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू टेक द अप्रोप्रिएट एक्शन व्हिच आई एम सपोज्ड टू बी टेकिंग. सो इट विल लीड टू लापरवाही. एंड द वर्स्ट पार्ट इज आई एम नॉट ओनली रिसीविंग माई सेल्फ बट आई एम पुटिंग अदर्स ऑल्सो एट रिस्क. तो खुद और दूसरों को जोखिम पे डालना. तो if you know we fall, it's good to be aware that if I have this optimistic bias in my mind, I should get my facts clear. And I think the good example for this could be Italy, right? So if I know that somewhere I'm falling in this category where I'm very optimistic about it, I'm not taking the necessary precaution, please get a fact clear from the right sources. So these are the two extremes. Now what we are aiming at is coming in between. That is concern. What is concern? Concern means realistic appraisal of the risk. That is, I should be viewing the situation in a realistic and a rational way, not undermining the risk, not overestimating the risk, right? This will help me to mentally be relaxed. At the same time, take the necessary precautions. That is, yahan se main shant rahunga and jo bhi precaution leni hai, main le paunga, right? So this is what we are aiming at. So I would request everyone to maybe get a pen and a paper so that we are going to do an activity, and we will try to, if we fall under either of the extreme spectrums, we'll be able to come in between. Okay, so everyone just get a pen and a paper and we are going to start an activity. So this activity is called as circle of control. And so what we are going to draw is two circles, circle of control and circle of no control, as you can see in the PPT. What lies inside is going to be the things which are in my control. What lies outside the circle are going to be things which are not in my control, right? Now, this exercise we are going to do for three aspects, which are very relevant currently: my health, my finances, that is my wealth, and the situation overall. So we could draw three circles, right, with respect to our health, wealth, and situation. So let us start with the first, which is health. Okay. So health. Okay. So let me understand first what is in my control, which will fall under the inner circle. That is washing my hands, keeping hygiene, staying at home, and of course my peace of mind. So these are the things which are in my control. What are the things which are not in my control are, you know, the national medical policies or India getting to stage 3 or even getting infected. But what is largely in my control is things which I can do, right? So what will Chintaram do? Can you all just guess? Chintaram will keep worrying about things which are not in control. And what will Mastaram do? Mastaram will not even bother to think of the things which are actually in his control. So these are two extremes. What will the Shri Ram, the concerned person, will do is, he will do all the things which are needed within his control and let go mentally of the factors which are not in his control. He will not brood, he will not be anxious, he will not be frustrated, right? So this is largely, and this not only applies to the current scene, at any given point in your life, you can always apply this, right? The next. So the next is my finances. I'm sure as businessmen, we might be worried, or the economy is going, the world economy is actually falling. I might get thoughts, what next? But what I have to do is again draw two circles and think, what are the things which are not in my control? So the economy, loss in business, the lockdown, right? We don't know this, the entire quarantine or the lockdown, government policies, labor migration. These are things technically not in my control. What are the things which fall in my realm or the control in the inner circle? First and foremost, my peace of mind. No situation can shake that. We have to be very clear. No situation ever should shake my peace of mind. That is completely in my control, right? Next, my expenses, my resource allocation, my standard of living, the my business decision and the financial planning. So these are the things which are in my control. And during these days, I can totally work on them so that I'm prepared for the future, rather than constantly brooding or getting worried or depressed or frustrated about things which are not in my control, right? So in Hindi, I would just say, जो चीज मेरे हाथ के बाहर है, वो बाहर के सर्कल में आएंगी. जो चीज मेरे हाथ के अंदर है, मेरे कंट्रोल में है, वो अंदर आएंगी, right? जो चीज मेरे हाथ में है, उसी पे मैं मेरा पूरा focus करूँगा attention and उसी पे work करूँगा. Next, the situation at large, the lockdown. It's not in my control. I can't step off my house. I know that. What are things in my control? How do I spend time more constructively inside my house? So rather than saying I'm stuck, this lockdown is, you know, what is government doing, all that, I'm going to focus, okay, what is in my control? I can introspect, I can reflect, you know, during these days, I can self-nurture, I can spend some quality time with my family, or I can, you know, if interested, I can get into something spiritual, or, you know, pursue my hobbies. So again, what I'm doing is I'm going to do the best with the things which I have in my mind. So now let's go to the next topic of the conflict the situation is bringing with the three things around us, that is self, situation, and the significant other. So I'm sure this situation has brought, yes, सिचुएशन ने एक तनाव लाया है जो मेरे अंदर भी चल रहा होगा, एक परिस्थिति ऑन अ लार्जर लेवल, देयर इज सम कॉन्फ्लिक्ट, एंड ऑफ कोर्स सम कॉन्फ्लिक्ट विद माय फैमिली मेंबर्स, बिकॉज़ द क्वारंटाइन, दो आई वांट पीपल, बट इट इज आयरन इन इटसेल्फ दैट आई एम लॉक्ड डाउन विद पीपल, एंड बिकॉज़ आई माइट स्टार्ट हैविंग सम कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स विद देम, बिकॉज़ वी आर जस्ट लॉक्ड डाउन, राइट? सो वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट ईच factor in a very brief sense, right? So let's first talk about the conflict the situation has brought within myself, right? This situation has been a sudden pause to the rush. We have never ever been in such a situation of such a long span where we are just, you know, all the routes of escape are just shut, right? So there could be an underlying boredom, frustration, or constant thoughts which could be running. So, you know, it's like sitting idle. We have never ever been taught to sit idle. So bina kaam ya bina soch mein rehna is like very frightening. Bahut dar lagta hai soch se bhi. How can I just be idle, right? Or it might lead to restlessness, agitation, or non-stop thoughts. I'm sure like people are experiencing this at some level. Suddenly my stimulation has gone and I'm bored, I might be frustrated. So let's introspect. Am I going through this? You know, let's sit and think that, is it an underlying current? Am I going through this? Right? So where do we jump there? Like when I'm experiencing this kind of frustration, where do I go? So I know like we all might be jumping to technology or the phones or the social media to escape from this boredom, escape from my running thoughts. Where do I go? So I go to, you know, constantly WhatsApping, Netflixing, you know, binge watching, or, you know, jumping from one app to another, or forwarding useless messages. Like I'm reading constantly messages and just forwarding. I'm sure it's, again, it's not bad. Social media is not bad. But the learning here is it compulsive in nature? Is it like, kuch nahi karne ko, it's like an itch. It's, you know, every 5 minutes, I'm just taking my phone. Every 5 minutes, I'm just checking my phone. So this kind of compulsivity is something that we need to work on, right? So social media is good. Technology, Netflix is good. I'm not against it. All I'm saying is the amount of use, the intensity is something we'll have to be more mindful about. So, or, you know, repeatedly watching news. Pura din news dekhte rehna. Wahi ka, wahi, corona, 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 corona. Ya phir substance use. People who are, might, because to escape from the boredom, which I'm experiencing inside, and the thoughts, I'm just using an external substance, alcohol or cigarette or anything. Or instigating fights. I'm sorry, the last part of the slide is a little getting cut, but yeah. So I'll just read out instigating fights. So, you know, when you have nothing to do, you might just hover over your family members and start instigating fights or remove the past, right? So again, it might be unconsciously I'm trying to escape the void or the boredom the present moment is coming up with. So hence, this entire session is about mindfulness. So we're going to talk about it later. So let's see the root cause of the problem. Where is this conflict inside me coming from? Let's introspect, right? The first is the past habit of constant busyness and stimulation. In our day-to-day life, especially Mumbai cars, we have a habit of being constantly busy or stimulated, right? So suddenly that has come to a pause, and because which leads to there's a habit of escaping the present moment on a very inside, on a mental level. Though my body is here, my mind is jumping, present, past, future, it's just jumping. So somewhere I'm escaping from the present moment. Next, fear of doing nothing or having nothing to think. So somewhere I'm fearing, like bina kaam ya soch, the very thought that of being idle, say dar lagta hai. How do I just be and do nothing, right? Or fear of being without any stimulation. So if nothing, the least stimulation I have is my phone. I just open my WhatsApp and just keep checking statuses, keep checking people's DP, seeing Instagram stories, or, you know, just keep checking the stock markets again and again and again and again. Why? Because I want something, some material my mind needs, right? So it's a good, I would say, the opportunity that it's like the life has forced us to stop and work on this constant, you know, need for stimulation of keeping busy or escaping the present moment, right? So now we jump to the topic of mindfulness meditation. Before we start that, there's a small disclaimer, right? Very small. This meditation is not for anyone suffering with a severe mental distress or illness. So if that case, they should go to a mental health professional. So don't use this meditation technique. If anyone is going through significant distress, then please go to a mental health professional. So, you know, if we would teach some yoga also, you know, they would give a disclaimer that if someone has a cardiac illness, they should not probably do Zumba or, you know, certain kind of, this is a general meditation for well-being. So not right now, we are not going in the spectrum of people who are suffering with severe distress. So it's a small disclaimer. So if that's the case, please be mindful. Let's start with the main topic. What is mindfulness? Okay. So yes, mindfulness is a technique. Mindfulness is a technique. It's an ancient technique, but the modern psychology has revived it to train your mind to just be in the present moment. So it's like a technique. We go to gym for building our physical muscles. It's like a training of the mind to work on this habit to be in the present moment. That is training the mind to be at peace even without stimulation. And in Hindi, I would call it Nivruti may be Anand Pane ki kala. So even when I don't have things to do, I'm very okay with it. I'm very fine to be in the present moment. And last but not the least, it's got the metaphor of taming the monkey mind. The mind has been given the metaphor of monkey. It keeps jumping. So it's like taming your mind slowly to very gently to learn a new way of being, that is being in the present moment. So it's like a training, form of training, mindfulness meditation, where we can start cultivating, not only for this period, but throughout our life, right? It's something very helpful, trust me. So let us start with mindfulness. Okay, so it's like, I've just given a metaphor, like the monkey mind, and we are going to learn to train our monkey mind to be in the present. Okay, so what is mindfulness? In Hindi, you know, it's a complex term though, but I've just added. In Hindi, it's called Sahaj Vishrammay Jagruti. So it's very effortless and relaxing awareness, right? So a definition would go something like this. Anchoring mind to the present moment, that is feeling the present moment through senses and becoming aware of this present moment with openness, curiosity, and equanimity. So training my mind to feel this moment, not think, not chatter, but feel this moment through my senses. That is the five senses or the breath, and become aware with three things, with openness, curiosity, and equanimity. We'll discuss this in the next slide. In Hindi, for my Hindi viewers, is kshan mein jo bhi ho raha hai, uska bina koi baudhik tol map ya mulyankan, is kshan ko swikar karna shant bhav se. So, just a second. Okay, by the way, today is Ram Navami, so yeah, we have to become Shri Ram. Okay, so I'm sorry, there was some low voice in the beginning, but yeah. So again, for Hindi viewers, let's come back. Is kshan mein jo bhi ho raha hai, uska bina koi baudhik mulyankan, bina koi, you know, chatter or analysis, I'm going to feel this moment, uska swikar karna, and shant bhav se dekhna. Like, jo bhi ho raha hai, usse main shant bhav se dekhunga. I'm going to feel this moment, right? So this is what the essence of mindfulness meditation is, to train our mind to be in this moment, feel this moment with purely openness, curiosity, and equanimity, right? So, So you can see this image on the left-hand side. The person is, you know, there, but where is he here? He's not in the present. He's all over cluttered. Multiple apps going on in his mind. His mind is in the past, future, so many things constantly running. And in the right-hand side, the person is, his body is here and his mind is here, right? So I agree that you can't be always that, but it's just like you're training your mind slowly, little by little. And slowly, it's just like a habit we are cultivating, right? So we want to shift from this, the left-hand side to the right-hand side of being in the present moment, where my body is, my mind is, right? So let's revise the 5 points that mindfulness has. Number one, sensory awareness with soft and gentle attention. That is being aware of my senses. And with a very soft attention. So it's not very focused and concentrated, like, oh, no. Very soft attention and being aware of my senses, like all the inputs of my senses, like indriyo ke prati sahaj jagruta. Second, being non-judgmental. So no bodhik mulyankan. Agar let's say main baitha hoon wahan chamach ki, you know, chamach giri. Arey kyun giri? Nahi girni chahiye thi. No, my intellectual judgment. Okay, chamach giri. Uska awaaj maine suna. Okay. Third, being openness. That is pratik shan ke pratik khule man se avkare. I'm going to welcome each moment with openness. Let this moment come as it is coming. Fourth, curiosity. Lot of jigyasa. Like a small child, I'm going to be very curious about this moment. Oh, so let's say I'm sitting here. I'm very curious that the air of the fan is touching me. Like, wow. Like, let me see how it feels like, you know, how does the fan feel? being very curious, even if I know it's a very mundane thing, बहुत ही regular चीज है, but that's what mindfulness is about. We are going to be curious for small little things happening in the present moment. And last, being very equanimous, that is being Sambha. I'm going to see it, even if it's very good, if it's cool air or if it's very warm air, but I'm going to see it with lot of equanimity somehow, right? So these are five things that we'll keep, we'll be aware about mindfulness meditation. So next, okay, so some techniques of mindfulness. One is breath awareness. I can be aware of my going, ongoing breath. Saanson ke prati jagriti. Second, mindful eating. That is, main jo bhi kha raha hun, main usse sajagta se khaunga. The entire act of eating will be done with mindfulness. Third, mindful walking. So even if I'm walking in my house, I'm going to walk mindfully. Otherwise, what happens? My body is walking, but my mind is taking the tour. I don't know where. I'm just thinking. I don't even realize how many rounds I have walked. Fourth, mindful exercising. So whatever, you know, whatever awareness ke saath I am, whatever exercise I'm doing, but I'm not going to put my headphones, listen to music, but I'm going to be mindful of my body. The very act of exercising. So it's not limited to these four techniques. There can be anything you can be mindful about. But I'm just giving you, formal mindfulness meditation may involve one of the four techniques. So I think, let me just browse through some techniques. First is mindful breathing, where we become aware of the breath, like how the breath is going in, how the breath is going out. Then my breath is touching, it's going inside, then my belly is, you know, it gets expanded. When I breathe out, how my chest goes in, and the air is just becoming aware with curiosity, right? Even if thoughts come, thoughts will come. Okay, it's monkey mind. You have to be very gentle. Bring it back again in the present moment. Don't be very harsh. Oh, why did my mind go? No, I have to get it back. No, be very gentle. If your mind goes again, break the monkey back to the watching the breath. So one of the techniques. Second, mindful eating. Whatever I'm eating, let's say I'm going to like consider my chai or anything, I'm going to eat with entire awareness. That is, I have taken the morsel, I'm chewing, you know, I can feel my saliva, the texture, color, smell, and I'm gulping, swallowing. As it's going down, I can feel it in my food pipe and inside. So I'm eating mindfully. So, and I can tell you, if you start eating mindfully, the quantity of the food will be much more optimum. Neither less to nor more, because you will be hearing your body's, you'll be hearing your body saying that, yeah, I'm done, right? Next, mindful stretching. So as I said, whichever exercise you're doing, will be more aware while you are exercising. Or I'll tell you something very relevant to current time, washing vessels with mindfulness. How will you do that? So while you're washing, you'll be aware of your body washing, your hands moving, you'll be aware of the sound of the water, the smell of the soap, the effervescence, and you know how the dishes are getting clean, and you'll be completely doing it. And that's meditation. That's meditation. That's completely, definitely a meditation. So you could be doing that also, right? So let's do a short meditation on breath awareness. So I would request everyone to sit aram se, hands on your lap. Okay. So I'm going to start a meditation. Everyone ready? Sit comfortably. Gently close your eyes. Focus your attention on my voice. अब हम 5 मिनटों के लिए अपनी सांसों को देखने का ध्यान करेंगे. इन 5 मिनटों के लिए अपने मन से कहें, हे मन, तुझे कहीं नहीं पहुंचना, कहीं नहीं जाना, कुछ नहीं पाना, ना ही कुछ खोना. तू इस वर्तमान क्षण में आराम कर. अब हम 3 लंबी सांस लेंगे. सांस लेते समय
अपने पेट को फुलाएं और सांस छोड़ते समय अपने पेट को अंदर सिकोड़े। आप चाहे तो अपना एक हाथ अपनी छाती पर और दूसरा हाथ अपने पेट पर रख सकते हैं। आप चाहें तो अपना ध्यान अपने नासिका के द्वारों पर भी रख सकते हैं। अब हम हमारी पहली लंबी सांस लेंगे। सांस अपने नाक से लें और सांस अपने मुंह से छोड़ें। पहली लंबी सांस लें और सांस छोड़ें। दूसरी लंबी सांस लें और सांस छोड़ें। तीसरी लंबी सांस लें और सांस छोड़ें। मेरा मन शांत हो रहा है। अब अपनी सांसों को अपने आप चलने दें। सांस जैसी चल रही है बिना प्रयास के उसे वैसे चलने दें। सांस आ रही है और जा रही है। सांस आ रही है और जा रही है। सांस आ रही है और मैं जान रहा हूं कि सांस आ रही है। सांस जा रही है और मैं जान रहा हूं कि सांस जा रही है। इस बीच कोई अन्य विचार आए कोई बात नहीं, उसमें ना उलझते अपने ध्यान को प्यार से अपनी सांस पर लाएं। सांस आ रही है और मेरा पेट फूल रहा है। सांस जा रही है और मेरा पेट सिकुड़ रहा है। सांस को इसी प्रकार संभाव से देखें। मैं शांत हो रहा हूं। मैं प्रेम से भर रहा हूं। यह पल अनमोल है। सांस आ रही है और मैंने जाना कि सांस आ रही है। सांस जा रही है और मैंने जाना कि सांस जा रही है। मैं इस चलती सांस का आभारी हूँ। हमारे 5 मिनट पूरे हुए। हल्के से अपनी आंखों को खोले, मुस्कुराए और वापस वर्तमान क्षण में जागृत हो जाए। सो यू माइट हैव गॉट सम थॉट्स, इट्स ओके, इट्स अ प्रैक्टिस। स्लोली 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 वंस यू ट्रेन योर माइंड, you will be okay to get it back in the present moment. It will automatically get trained. In gym, initially body aches when you do, you know, do weightlifting or cardio, but eventually your body gets accustomed. Similarly, you're training your mind to be in the present moment, right? Okay. The next, how can you apply this mindfulness in your day-to-day life? While drinking tea, you can decide, this is my mindfulness meditation, drinking tea. Smelling the tea or, you know, and being very mindful of the taste, the smell, the entire feel of drinking tea. And all you're doing is not thinking about what next, I have to go to office or I have to do this, but just enjoying those 5 minutes and drinking your tea mindfully. Or brushing your teeth or washing hands. I'm sure we are all washing hands 3 to 4 times. Each time you go near the basin to wash your hands, You're going to be aware of the gushing water of your hands, of the soap, and wash your hands mindfully. Be there. So you're, what you're doing is all the scattered mind is coming back to the very act of washing. Or while walking, or while waiting for a lift. Of course, not now. But in general, when we wait for the lift, we are so, you know, like, so agitated, like, when will the lift come? But what we can do is, okay, anyway, the lift will come. You remember the circle on its own time. It's not in my control. All I can do is, okay, let me just practice 2 minutes of mindfulness. Or last but not the least, when you're stuck in traffic. Okay. So again, if you were to drink tea mindfully, you would be doing with all the 5 things. Okay. Let me tell you, corporates are using mindfulness. So Google, large organizations like Google, Target or General Mills are actually investing in mindfulness. So mindfulness is needed at workplace because the efficiency and productivity will increase. Employees will learn to anchor their mind in the present moment. Otherwise, though we are working outside, but mentally we are just scattered. And of course, it will reduce the stress. So Steve Jobs, you know, is actually been doing mindfulness for a very long time, or Vallabh Bhansali, or even Kirit Gala. So these are like live pioneers who have been practicing mindfulness. Mindfulness, of course, has personal benefits. It will help you focus better, you know, bringing your mind, which is scattered, back, better decision-making. Of course, when your mind is in the present moment, decluttered, the decisions will be better. It will reduce your stress. And research says that, yes, it reduces your stress. So better immunity and emotional regulation, you know, the ups and downs will go more, will be more calm. And last but not the least, if ever we have to take nivruti, like suddenly we are ever some situation comes that again we are locked down, we won't be very frustrated. We'll be very okay being without stimulations and being very idle. Okay. So let's come from self to the situation. So we might be also fighting mentally with the situation through counterfactual thinking. What is counterfactual thinking? Thinking against the situation. वास्तविकता के विरुद्ध संघर्ष करना, मानसिक संघर्ष करना. इज ए एग्जाम्पल हियर. इट्स रेनिंग, बट इफ आई एम काउंट एंगेजिंग इन काउंटर फैक्चुअल थिंकिंग, आई विल बी लाइक, आई डोंट लाइक दिस रेन, आई विश इट वाजंट रेनिंग, व्हाई इज इट रेनिंग, माय डे इज स्पॉइल्ड, डा 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 डा. आई एम जस्ट, यू नो, एंगेजिंग इन काउंटर फैक्चुअल थिंकिंग. बट इफ आई एम एक्सेप्टिंग इट, आई विल बी लाइक, यस, इट्स रेनिंग, दैट्स ऑल, राइट? सो लेट्स अप्लाई दिस टू द करंट सिनेरियो. If it's non-acceptance of the situation, the lockdown is frustrating. Badi mushkil se, you know, my business was going good. Ye kahan fas gaye? Vyapar acha chal raha tha. Kyun hua? Ye China ki conspiracy hai. Government useless hai. Kach kyun nahi chale gaye? Etc. etc. So again, it's engaging in counterfactual thinking. What is it resulting to? Anger, frustration, anxiety, restlessness. In contrast, if I would be accepting the situation, I'll be like, okay, this has happened. Ye jo hua hai, wah sachai hai. Now I have to follow the guidance. I'll use this time for all the best things I can do, like focus on myself, or nurture my family. And what will it result to? Peace, creativity, and joy. So the next thing in the triangle, conflict with others. Since we have the physical space is reduced, I'm sure the big boss is no longer in TV, but to some extent in the houses also, because we are forced to be with people around us in a very limited physical space. But right now we are going to focus on the psychological space. Let's give each other some psychological space. Just because people are at home around me, that doesn't mean I hover over them all the time. Mandrao mat. Let's decide, okay, this is a time we'll come together and we'll discuss over things. But you can also say that, okay, these are times, please don't disturb me. I'll be focused on my work. Next, please say thank you multiple times to your family members for cooperating. Like, I'm sure the house chores, we are very dependent on house helpers, like in India especially. Please keep all your identities aside, all your professional identities aside. No, I am in my house just a family member. I may be a CEO, MD, whatever, outside. Here, I should be helping equally in the house chores. And please have clearly communicated roles. Okay, bartan kaun karega? Jhadu pocha kaun karega? Ya fir the clothes, like kapde kaun karega? So that we don't expect like usko itna nahi samajhta hai. Itna to khud se nahi hota hai. No, let's have clear communicated roles. Next, please understand that people might be reacting to their own frustration. So even if they, please don't take it personally, let go. You be mindful and don't take it personally. So people might, you know, be in a very frustrated or reactive mode. Let's not get frustrated. Let's think that, okay, give them the benefit of doubt. Maybe they're just reacting to their own irritation and frustration. Let's not take it personally. Final tips, as we are working from home, some might, some are not, but still, please get ready in the morning as if it's a fresh day, a working day, wear good clothes. Please have your physical space organized. Have a timetable and a physical space organized so that you know this is my workspace. Like even in the house, please have that. If you're slouching on the bed with a laptop and working, it actually has an effect on your psyche, right? Have a clear timetable and a structure. Please set a clear time for social media that, okay, evening 6 to 7, I'll open all my WhatsApp messages like family groups, all my friends groups. But till then, let me have the mental discipline. Next, physical exercise is must. I'm sure home chores are taking that care of the physical exercise, but still some amount of formal mindful exercising is good. Next, mindfulness meditation. Let's take this opportunity to start this formal practice every day, maybe 2 minutes, maybe 5 minutes of mindfulness. Let's train our mind, not just for this quarantine, but throughout our life to be in the present moment. Next, spend time for hobbies. Spend meaningful time with your families, maybe through some indoor games or something. Please help in the house chores, again, a request. Next, sleep hygiene. Just because we are at home, we are with our phones till 12, 1, 2, watching Netflix, binge watching, no. Don't mess up with your sleep. 10 to 4 is the best time, quality time for your sleep. Your brain works in, you know, it's called circadian rhythm. So your brain works in sync with the sun. As the sun is rising, the quality of sleep goes down. Please don't, you know, be on Netflix. Just decide, and like if you go to Netflix, but not after 10 or 11. Let's maintain the hygiene of sleeping. And last but not least, you can't see though, it's maintain food intake hygiene. Just because I'm at home, pura din, you know, just taking things and putting in your mouth without being aware, not good. Like don't keep just eating wafers and biscuits. No, have just like it was a hop office. Let's, you know, keep our slots very clear. Breakfast, like maybe lunch, then snack and dinner, and of course healthy things. Not just because Maggie and biscuits, because it also has an effect on our emotions and mind, right? So these are some tips that I could give you. Last but not the least, please don't wait to rest in peace. Rather, let's start living in peace. Let's start this mindfulness practice and practice this art and science of being in the moment, right? Thank you very much for being a lovely audience. All you can ask your questions. You all can ask your questions in the QA section given below. In your screen, I'll try my best to answer as much as questions as possible. Also, if any like further queries, you can always contact and reach me out, you know, on my email ID or WhatsApp on my number. So thank you very much. I'm going to stop my screen and I'll start taking questions. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Suraj, for a fantastic introduction to mindfulness technique. Before taking the questions, I would like to thank Mr. Suraj Shah for introducing us to this wonderful technique called mindfulness.
Thank you so
much. I'm sure all of us will practice this in our day-to-day life regularly, and particularly this period, which is, we all are at home and literally doing, actually mindfulness is a helpful technique in this kind of a period. I would also like to make one announcement that on this Saturday, which is 4th April at 8 p.m., we are having one more webinar where Padma Bhushan awardee, Dr. Jagdish Sheth, is going to talk on how can Indian businesses cope with COVID-19 disruption. Details of the webinar will be sent to you via email and SMS. Kutch Corporate Forum is organizing such events since last 25 years. If you would like to become a member of KCF, you can reach out to us on info@kcfindia.in. I would also like to take this occasion to thank all of y'all for taking your very valuable time out and joining us here. It's been a record attendance, and you know, I would really like to thank each one of you for having spent the time to try and see how we can pass through this phase in the best possible way. That has been our effort. In addition to that, I would like to thank Vivek Thakkar from Boomerang, Vivek Thakkar from Boomerang Consulting for all the behind the scenes work, all the great coordination that you're seeing over here. So with that, we'll take the first question for today.
Yeah. So Mr. Mitesh has asked a question.
Yeah.
How do you distinguish between mindful and unmindful? Okay. So I'm not sure what the word unmindful, I think he meant unmindful. I think the way to distinguish between whether you're mindful or no is when your body is here, but mentally you are scattered. So I'm saying that you cannot always be mindful. You cannot always be in present. Of course, you have to plan about future. You have to reflect on your past. But the whole idea of mindfulness is, even if I'm doing that, I'm aware of that. I am okay. I'm sitting there, I'm planning about my future. The habitual, the compulsive thinking, you know, I'm like a headless chicken. My mind is going here and there. That's called very unmindful. But being mindful is that where my body is, my mind is at peace in the very moment, right? So that could be one of the ways to distinguish between mindful and unmindful. The next question is, can you elaborate on mindful eating? So I know that I've not covered, I've just touched upon the mindfulness. Of course, it's a very elaborate topic. You can actually have entire training session for mindfulness, but in a very short, I would like to answer that mindful eating is when you're aware of the very act of eating. That is, what are the senses that you will be engaging? Mm-hmm. Your vision, that you're watching you're seeing the food, you're taking the morsel, you're putting in your mouth, you are, while you are chewing, you're aware of that, you know, the entire process of chewing, you're swallowing, and you're slowly, you know, swallowing the food. So the very act of eating with all your senses, enjoying eating with all your senses, rather than, you know, watching TV and we don't even realize, oh, my plate is over. You know, we are such in an autopilot mode that we are eating, but, you know, I just don't realize that my food is over. So that's not mindful eating. And the very important part of mindful eating is you will be actually aware, oh, my body's done. Most of the times we do overeat. You know, we don't realize that the satiation signal is not reaching to your mind because we are so engaged. Next, how long can the meditation be? I think there is no specific time limit, but you can start with 2 minutes, 5 minutes, eventually 10 minutes, 15 minutes, right? So again, there is no time limit, but you can start with 2 minutes. But again, do not force yourself into meditation. Build it slowly. You know, it happens that you might just go, I want to meditate for 15 minutes and you end up being frustrated. No, that's not the point of meditation. So you maybe start with 2 minutes, 3 minutes, and slowly increase the span, right? But the maximum span is something where it's effortless. So if you're effortlessly doing it for 2 minutes, that's your optimum span, and slowly increase.
Yeah. Next question, Suraj, I'll put the questions to you.
Sure.
So dear Suraj, very nicely put things in right perspective and simple language. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
I have one question. Isn't binge watching a way of de-stressing, and as we forget our surroundings and get fully involved?
Yeah. A very good question. Am I not mindful while I'm watching Netflix? Right? I'm not thinking. I'm not in the past or future. I'm in the moment. So, okay, let me just ask you a simple question. After binge watching for 2 hours or 3 hours, when you are you fresh? Really, are you fresh? Or you switch it off after having, a very clouded mind? So that can actually answer your question. Is it really helping me to declutter? Is it really helping me to feel fresh and at peace? Or it's just clouding my thoughts? Because what are we watching on Netflix? We are watching intense emotions. We are watching some thriller or some very intense. You're giving us a very high stimulation. Remember, the mind gets tired with high stimulation. So though it acts as a way to escape, but what am I needing? Do I need such high stimulation to escape? Can a simple breath act as a very, it's very low stimulation, breath, okay, what's so great about breath? But with practice, I'm training my mind that even with a simple stimulation of breath, or, you know, sitting outside my balcony, watching the sky, that's enough for me to settle down. So it's, again, and trust me, it will end up making you more fresh. You'll be more clear. It won't cloud your mind, and your emotions will be at peace. So that's something experientially you should experience and then understand, oh, that, you know, is Netflix better or this better? Yeah, next question, please.
Yeah, thank you for such a guidance. I want to ask if we need to follow some sound while meditating, like today you were guiding us through the meditation. Similarly, is there some sound that should be used?
So initially, it's good to have a guided meditation because the mind needs something to focus. So I can recommend this app called Headspace. Headspace is an app which you can, you know, download and use, or there are other apps like Calm, which have guided 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes meditations. And then you can, once you get the technique, then you don't need a guided, because then your breath is enough for mindfulness. But it comes at a little later stage. Initially, it's good to have something guided so that your mind is anchored there. Otherwise, it will like, the thoughts will be like, am I doing it right? Am I not doing it right? You know, again, you'll get lost.
Suraj, can you just repeat the names of these apps for the benefit, and a little slowly so that people can get them?
Headspace, HEADSPACE, Headspace. Second, the Calm. So these are two apps which are like very good, and they are designed by professional psychologists. So they are not like some simply, you know, made up apps. Yeah.
The next question, I believe the today's seminar was about that, but I'll still ask it. How to cope up and come out of anxiety or fear?
It's a good question. So again, first, please decide whether the anxiety and the fear you are, how severe and intense it is. As I told, if it is severe and intense, don't do self-remedies, don't do this mindfulness. If it's severe, it's something causing you real trouble, please see a mental health professional. Then he will be able to guide you further. But if it's something not very severe, and it's something that, you know, it's not very mild, that is something, it's not, I'll tell you, how do you decide again what is mild and severe? It's not disturbing your day-to-day life. It's not very painful in your body. Like, you know, severe anxiety could be like palpitations, getting sweat, having difficult to breathe, or these are something severe or difficult to, you know, to sleep, or inability to control thoughts, like beyond your control, you know, then you should see a professional. Then I would not be able to answer right now. So, yeah.
So there's another question, a very different question. We are told to be overreacting to the present situation. So how do you justify it?
See, again, it depends whether they're overreacting or under. There are sections of the society which are undermining the risk, who are stepping out and, you know, are callous. There might be a section of society which are, you know, panicking and buying stuff more than needed, etc. How do you decide is, as I said, ask yourself that, is this emotion really helping me to take the necessary precaution or no? So irrespective of what people are saying, you can always introspect within yourself that, am I being the Chintaram, or am I being the Mastaram, or am I being the Shriram? So it's your introspection. And if you still think you're not able to gauge, maybe you should talk to someone. Yeah.
My mind is continuously becoming negative. So what should I do?
Okay. So if your mind is constantly becoming negative, start writing your thoughts. What are the negative thoughts? And then once you actually pen down your thoughts, probably then you can decide which thoughts are helpful, which thoughts are not helpful, and probably what is the root of the thought. So for example, if your negative thought is about being, you know, pessimism, like, oh my God, what is going to happen in the next future? Then you can again ask yourself and find a more rational way to look at it. So reframe your thoughts, actually pen down and start viewing your thoughts more rationally. Maybe you can ask 4 people that, this is a thought. Can you give me a perspective on?
Okay, I think there's a line drop. I think we'll just wait for a minute to reconnect and try and see if, anyway, we are near the end of the seminar. We're just about a few minutes away. So just if we can just hold on for the line to reconnect, we'll just try and quickly reconnect.
Yeah. Hello. Yes. Can you hear me? Yeah, I'm sorry, there was some glitch.
So we are back.
Yeah, we're back.
So there are two questions which are quite similar. So how do you reduce the clutter running in my mind? Please give some tips. And the second question, if someone has a habit of multitasking, how can he go with mindfulness? In a way, both are in a similar zone. Yeah.
So again, mindfulness is not against multitasking. Okay, people might think mindfulness is like becoming a monk, doing one thing at a time. No, not really. Mindfulness is about the inner thing. So even if I'm multitasking outside, I'm very well aware, okay, I'm doing three things at the same time. But I'm not multitasking out of fear and panic. Oh my God, ye bhi baki hai, wo bhi baki hai, ye bhi baki hai. So I'm just, you know, jumping on one or the other things without actually having some clear-cut, predefined structure to it. Multitasking, if done with structure, and if done with when your mind is here, and also multitasking done which you can actually justify to. If you're doing five things at a time and your cognitive resources, that your attentional resources are not doing justice to five things, rather stick to three things or two things. But again, how will you decide? Clear, the simple tagline mantra is my mind in the where my body is. If you think you are in your senses, grounding in the present moment, even if I'm doing three things at a time, I'm at peace and I'm very much, you know, doing it with a very clear cut conscious awareness that, okay, I'm doing three things and this is what I'm supposed to achieve out of these three things. Yeah.
Suraj, we'll take the last couple of questions because we are almost running out of time from our schedule. One is a very operational question. Is there any particular time in a day when we need to practice mindful meditation? And part B within that is, you know, is there any empty stomach condition needed for that or any other such condition?
So mindfulness meditation does not tell you that there is some prerequisite. Even if I'm walking, I can walk mindfully. See, it's all about the approach, because I'm always aware, like the awareness is there, but I just need to channelize into the present moment. But yeah, formal meditation, let's say if I've eaten like just after lunch, if I'm going to sit and practice breath awareness, possibly I won't be able to be aware of my breath because my stomach is very full, because that sensation is going to take over my other sensation. So maybe you can do some other meditation. Like you can be aware, you can sit, you can stand in the balcony and be more aware of the surroundings. So there is no such prerequisite as such. But whatever, if after eating you're feeling sleepy, then it's not good time to do mindfulness. Let the awareness, or if you're very tired, then you better sleep and regain, you know, your mental strength and then do the meditation. Because otherwise, if you're very tired or sleepy here, or then it's not advisable. So you decide where my awareness, when I'm at ease, when my awareness is, you know, very natural and in a very, I'm not forcing myself, then that's the right time to, you know, practice mindfulness. Yeah.
There's another question, which is, so mindfulness talks about being in the present, but my question is, we do plan, analyze, and logically think about situations. How do we apply mindfulness in such a situation?
Yes, as I said, do not mistake mindfulness for being in the present, like, okay, I can't think about the future. No, I will plan, but I will do it mindfully. Like I'll sit with a pen and paper, I'm planning about future, but not like a headless chicken, oh my God. But rather having a very, being grounded in the moment and being at peace. So my internal state is at peace and then I can start planning. So I will be planning with more clarity rather than out of anxiety or out of fear. So that's mindless. So do not confuse mindfulness with being strictly in the present. No. Yeah. Formal meditation, when you're practicing mindfulness formally for those 5 minutes, yes. Do practice it with your awareness in the present and without engaging in thinking. But mindfulness as an approach, as a way of life, it allows you to plan. It allows you to reflect in the past, but in a more calm and a peaceful way. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. I think there's so many questions. I'll take two more. One is how to be mindful to anger and frustration. I think it's a very good question.
Very, very good question. I really appreciate someone who's asked this question. Okay. Step one, when I'm feeling angry, most of the people tell us, don't be angry, forgive, be control of your anger. I would say no, nothing works. When I'm angry, the step one is become mindful that, yes, I am feeling angry. Be curious that, let's say I'm very angry and just want to go out and blast on someone. So what I do is I sit and I curiously start talking to myself and experiencing, okay, let me see what this anger feels like. Where is this anger coming? So let's say if this anger is coming from the fact that someone said to me and he should have not said the way he was rude. Okay, let me sit with this feeling with lot of love. So those five things apply to my anger also. If I'm judgmental towards my anger is bad, I shouldn't get angry. Then you're just adding to the anger. So I have to be curious towards my anger. Let me see. How does it feel like you anger? Be very compassionate to yourself that, yes, I understand and I'm feeling angry. Tell me, Suraj, what is it that is bothering you? Yes, let us experience it. Okay, I may feel that my heart is palpitating and I can feel a flow of gush. So I'm mindful about it. I'm curious. I'm being non-judgmental. And I will sit with myself. So neither I am exploding my anger, nor I am, suppressing my anger. Most of the people tell us to suppress the anger. Anger kharab hai, buda hai. But no, we are not going to do either. We are going to process it mindfully. Go to the cause, root cause of my anger. Maybe someone, something that, it's hurt my ego. Or is it that legitimately someone has crossed the boundary? Let me sit with it. And then I can go. Once I'm settled, my anger is settled, I can go out and tell the person very assertively, but in a very calm way that, hey, look, I just felt a little angry and I just wish that you shouldn't be rude the next time. So that will help me, in fact, to go and process my anger. First, process it mindfully, be calm, then go and be assertive and tell the person that I didn't like the way you spoke to me.
One more question. What is the difference between mindfulness and meditation?
Yeah, so as I said, mindfulness, number one, is a way of life, of course, but mindfulness meditation is a formal practice, right? So when I say mindfulness meditation, it's a formal practice of 5 minutes, 10 minutes where you use something, maybe breath, maybe your chai, maybe while brushing your teeth. That's mindfulness meditation. But mindfulness as a way of life is just generally being, allowing yourself to be, the five pointers, ingraining it in your value system. That's the larger scale. And as you said, the meditation otherwise are of multiple types. One of the types is mindfulness meditation. So there are hundred of ways of doing meditation. One of the ways is mindfulness meditation.
Okay. I think there's a huge outpour of questions.
Maybe they can email me.
I'll try one more.
Sure.
Since there is a, what about carrying out our hobbies? Is it a way for mindful meditation?
Absolutely. In fact, though we've never coined it mindfulness, practicing your hobby is in a way indirectly mindfulness only. But maybe now I'll be doing it with more awareness. So even if I'm like painting, these days there's something called mindfulness mandala and some fancy things coming up, but it's nothing. But even if I'm doing, let's say, if I am, playing tabla, I'll play with all my mindfulness rather than, constantly being anxious. Am I playing it right? Am I playing it wrong? No, I will just play the mindfulness, the tabla with mindfulness. Or if I'm chanting, let's say, if many people are doing mala. So if they're doing their mala, they'll do it mindfully. Okay, let me be aware of the voice. Let me be aware of the very act of doing mala. So anything can be a mindfulness meditation. Or if I'm singing, I'll be aware of the sound. I'll be aware of the pitch, the volume, and I'll enjoy it.
That's it, Suraj. Thanks a lot. Thank you everyone for joining in and asking such fantastic questions also, and participating wholeheartedly. Thank you again, Suraj.
Thank you so much, the KCF.
And looking forward for Saturday's seminar, which is again a very relevant topic for all of us. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Namaste, everyone.